When I read this scripture, it intrigued me a bit. And I'm kind of taking a different approach today. If you are a believer who insists that the gospel is written literally and that it is true in every word that is stated, then you probably could tune me out a little bit here because I'm going to use some imagination. If you're like me, you may have just zoned out on the reading of the gospel, but it's a familiar one where we know about the apostles, the stormy sea, and their fear. The apostles are at sea and there's a storm. Jesus appears walking on water. Peter questions Jesus and attempts to walk on water toward him. And failing, he is saved by Jesus. And that's the cliff notes of that scripture reading. I believe, or I have read, that this gospel was written about the time of serious persecution of the Christians by Nero around the year 64 or thereabouts. And St. Peter had been executed by being crucified upside down, and St. Paul had been beheaded. These Christians were suffering serious persecution. Now, there are parts of this scripture that I thought might bear a little examination. Maybe seeking a meaning into this vignette that the author of Matthew was trying to convey to us of an event in the life, the public life of Christ. Now, you may recall from your scripture readings that the blessing of the fish and the loaves and the feeding of the 5,000 had just ended. And if you project farther into your readings, you know that on the other side of the Sea of Galilee, they did this again for 3,000 people. Christ tells the apostles to get in the boat and to go to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, which was about 5 miles across at that time. He would, he tells them, remain with the crowds and make sure that they were safely on their way home. Well, logically, what do you think the apostles were thinking? How is Christ going to get to the other side of the sea? He tells them to get in the boat and take off. I'll catch up with you later. Well, there's no airplanes, helicopters, speedboats. They had a ship. I think Matthew was trying to tell us that Christ separated himself from the apostles. He left them to their own devices. They were alone. He then goes up the rise or the hill to pray. It's not dark yet, still at the end of the day. He prays as he did in the Garden of Gethsemane. Prior to his being separated from his apostles by force of the Roman centurions. He separates himself from the apostles by the sea, just like he did and was separated by the Romans. So the apostles are at sea, and we would think that they were fairly intelligent men. They were all fishermen. You'd think that they believed they could make this passage of 5 miles without much trouble. But they were caught in the middle of the sea. As humans, they must have been distracted somewhat by some worldly matter, some stories. Maybe they were talking about what they'd seen, what they'd done. They were kind of dawdling along, as I've been guilty of doing. And then it says at the fourth quarter, which is 4 in the morning, they find themselves in trouble, high seas and heavy winds. And one would ask oneself, what had they been doing for the last 8 hours? It's only a 5-mile journey by boat. They hadn't applied their oars or used their sails, apparently. Maybe Matthew was telling us that they were just plowing through this voyage, as we all do in life, a little bit casually, a little bit otherwise distracted. They were floundering like we do in our lives. And now it is dark, and they are surrounded by trouble. The sea is in tempest, the wind is fierce. They're in a bad spot, just as we find ourselves in bad spots in life. We confront or we face our fears, we're scared, we're frightened. It's life-changing, certainly. Life-threatening, emotionally charged, events that are not avoidable. These troubles surround us, as does the sea to these apostles. And lo, here comes Christ. Matthew says, as if he were a ghost. And it sounds a lot like the resurrection when Christ reappears to the apostles. And he says, do not be afraid. Do not be afraid of the unexplained. Do not be afraid of the unknown. And Peter, like many of us, perhaps all of us, he challenges Christ. If it is really you, Lord, prove to me that it is you, and then I will come walking to you on water. Do we need demonstrable proof that Christ is legitimate? And Peter did. Is that our attitude? And so Peter started, his faith failed, and he began to sink and desperately pleads to be saved. And he was. Christ promised to return to us, to save us by his death and resurrection. Peter, why did you doubt me? You have little faith. How often do we demand that God prove to us his existence? How often are our prayers demands on God for specific results? How often do we demand a miracle before we'll believe that Christ exists? We, in the depths of our intelligence and in our hearts, realize that we are powerless to force the outcome of our lives. We're unable to draw a road map with certainty that takes us from birth to death. As we plan or envision the journey, sort of like pushing a string of spaghetti. If we are honest and not naive, we realize that in the course of our lifetime, we too will find ourselves in the dark, alone, in trouble, with high seas and strong winds bringing adversity upon us, and all over which we have little control. We face life, death, sickness, we have to deal with relationships. And so I think that Matthew writes this story as a reminder of the death and resurrection of Jesus, who returns to save mankind. He is present in our lives to save us. He will allow us to venture through these troubles with grace and peace and dignity if we allow him to do so. If we don't shut him out by doubting his presence in our lives. Once I was walking down Main Street after coming out of court. I was going back to my office, and I was braced by two young men, looked to be in their mid to later 20s. One guy had a camera, and the other guy had a microphone. And they asked me who I thought Jesus was. I didn't know if I was being attacked by Hare Krishnas or what, but I told him and them that for me, Jesus was the person who walks by my side, and he has two fingers on my elbow, just a little bit like that. He gently steers me to the left, and he gently steers me to the right as I make decisions. He helps me find my way through the issues that I face every day. And faith in Jesus will allow us to live a life of peace and joy, going through the dark and stormy times and coming out on the other side. So my prayer for you today is that you live not in fear and doubt, but that you live in light and happiness in the daily presence of Christ Jesus. God bless.